"Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God." And specifically, I want to focus on the very first phrase that's there in verse number 20, where it says, "Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us." And the title of my sermon is Ambassadors for Christ. And let me start by saying this in the very beginning. That a lot of people in a church, a lot of church members get the idea that there are certain things for certain people to do within the church, and then there's things that they shouldn't be doing. And one of the things about, you know, about the local church, and one of the main purposes for the local church is to go soul winning, and is to reach the local area with the gospel. And that's the main reason why this church was even set up here to begin with, is because if you look at that map back there, you know, it's hardly been touched at all. And the view that Faith Forward Baptist Church in Tempe has is to knock every door in this area. But it's a huge job. So Pastor Anderson has this church located here so that we can try to knock all of the doors in North. So that's our job here. And it's not just the job of just a select group of people. And it's not just the job just for a pastor or just for a preacher or just for a deacon or just, you know, for certain people in the church. It is a job for every single person in the church to go soul winning, to be an ambassador for Christ. Now, to prove that, look at verse number 18, what it says. So Paul is writing to the Corinthians, to the church at Corinth, and he says this in verse number 18. "And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ." Now watch, so he said, notice he said, reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ. So he includes himself, but he's talking to those that he's writing to as well. And then he says this, "and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation." So all of those that are ambassadors for Christ is everyone that's been reconciled. So if you are saved, if you're a saved believer today and you've been reconciled unto Christ, then you automatically inherited with that the ministry of reconciliation. Automatically, that comes with, you know, with being a saved believer, with being a child of God. You become at that time an ambassador for Christ. And it doesn't matter whether you're doing your job or not, you're still an ambassador. Someone today could be an ambassador for a country. They could be a literal ambassador for a nation or for a kingdom or something throughout history or whatever. And it doesn't matter whether that person is doing their job or not. They're still given a responsibility. Whether they do it or not is besides the point. So if there's people, you know, that are saved believers, they have believed on Christ, they've been reconciled to God, the Bible says that he gave you the ministry of reconciliation and that you're an ambassador for Christ. And if you're not, you know, out soul winning and you're not out giving the gospel to people, that doesn't make you all of a sudden void of your responsibilities. That just makes you failing at your job. The Bible says that we are all ambassadors for Christ. All of us. Now, I'm going to preach this morning on being an ambassador for Christ, but I'm going to be a little bit specific about it as well. I'm going to use tips throughout this as kind of like tips for soul winning on things that you need to be an effective ambassador for Christ. So first, let's define terms. So first, turn to Proverbs chapter 13, verse 17. So we'll look at what being an ambassador is and what the word ambassador means. We get an idea, just one angle of it, because it basically has two aspects of the definition. And we get one aspect of it, actually, where we just read in verse number 20. I'll read it to you again. The Bible says, "Now then we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us." And then he says this, "We pray you in Christ's stead, be reconciled to God." So he said, we pray you in Christ's stead. So he's saying we're praying you in Christ's place. We're basically standing in the place of Christ. We're in the stead of Christ. So it's someone that is standing in the place of another person. It's someone that's standing between two people, but he's standing in the place of someone. It's basically a representative for another person. Now I'll read you too at the definition of ambassador from dictionary.com, just for a reference. The Bible says, dictionary.com says, "an authorized messenger or representative. So it says, it gives two parts there, an authorized messenger or representative. So you're in Proverbs chapter 13, verse 17. Is that what I said?
Yeah.
Proverbs chapter 13, verse 17 reads, a wicked messenger falleth into mischief, but a faithful ambassador is health. One of the great things about the book of Proverbs, obviously it's written to give wisdom. And the way that God gives wisdom to us oftentimes is He defines terms. And He has specific methods that He uses to define terms. He restates something twice. Or He contrasts two things. And that's exactly what he does here too. Is He gives two statements. And look what He says again. Look one more time in verse 17. A wicked messenger falleth into mischief, but a faithful ambassador is health. So we get a part of that definition, and it's equivalent with what we saw in 2 Corinthians about standing in Christ's stead, about being a representative. But then we also get the other aspect, and it lines up perfectly with this dictionary.com. They had two aspects or two parts of their definition as well. And the first part was an authorized messenger. So the two parts to being an ambassador is, number one, you're standing in someone's place, or you're standing in someone's stead. Number one, you're representing a certain person. And number two is, the reason why you're representing that person is because you're a messenger. That person has you standing in their stead, or they have you in their place because they have a specific message that they want you to convey, or that they want you to communicate. Another example of this, another good example, is in Exodus chapter 4, verse 14, where Moses, God is speaking unto Moses when He's giving him his job to go unto Pharaoh and to go unto the children of Israel. And He says this, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses. And He said, is not Aaron the Levite thy brother? I know that he can speak well. And also, behold, he cometh forth to meet thee. And when he seeth thee, he will be glad in his heart. And thou shalt speak unto him, and put words in his mouth. And I will be with thy mouth, and with his mouth, and will teach you what ye shall do. And then He says this, and he shall be thy spokesman unto the people, and he shall be to thee instead of a mouth, and thou shalt be to him instead of God. So basically we have here, you know, God set up this particular situation because Moses was basically complaining and crying about having to go and to be an ambassador for him. So God said, okay, well, you can have Aaron to be your spokesperson, but you're going to be standing in the stead of God, and then he'll be standing basically in the stead of your mouth. So he has two representatives basically. But Moses particularly in that place was being the ambassador for God. Obviously, we know that Moses, you know, ended up speaking quite a few different times throughout, you know, the story in Exodus to different people. So he did end up having to do that job, or having to fulfill that job as an ambassador, whether he wanted to or not. Now turn to Galatians chapter 4, verse 14. We'll see another example of this. Galatians chapter 4, verse 14. I'll read you from Luke chapter 9, verse 48. Luke chapter 9, verse 48 says this. Speaking of when Jesus speaking, it says, and said unto them, whosoever shall receive this child in my name receiveth me, and whosoever shall receive me receiveth him that sent me. So he's speaking unto his disciples. And when Jesus sent forth his disciples to go preach the gospel, he set up a system just like we saw in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. When he sent them forth, that, hey, you're representing me. And if someone receives you, it's as if they've received me. That's what Jesus says. So look at Galatians chapter 4, verse 14. I'm in Ephesians. Galatians chapter 4, verse 14. The Bible says in Galatians chapter 4, verse 14, Paul speaking says, and my temptation was in my flesh. He's speaking unto those in the church in Galatia, or to the Galatians in the church of Galatia. And he says this, I'll read one more time. And my temptation which was in my flesh, ye despised not, nor rejected, but received me as an angel of God. And oftentimes we think of the word as angel, of meaning like a celestial being. But it really means like messenger a lot. Just like we see here, the definition of an ambassador is a messenger. So he says, you received me as an angel of God. He's saying like a messenger of God. And then he says this, even as Christ Jesus. And we know that obviously Paul was going to Galatia to preach the gospel. That was the purpose of why he traveled around and why he went to all these different cities, was to preach the gospel. Just like when Jesus told his disciples, whosoever receives you, it's as they received me. And then Paul, when he's writing to the church of Galatia after they've been saved, after he's, you know, now he's trying to, you know, make sure that they're sound and they're founded in the faith, He says to them that you receive me as an angel of God, as a messenger of God. And then he says, even as Christ Jesus. Turn to Matthew chapter 10, verse 40. We'll look at another one. John chapter 13, verse 20 says this. Verily, verily, I say unto you, speaking unto his disciples again, Jesus, he says, he that receiveth whomsoever I send, receiveth me. And he that receiveth me, receiveth him that sent me. Like I said, that applies to you. That applies to you if you're sitting here and you're a saved person and you've been reconciled to God. Jesus says, if you go out and you preach the gospel, whosoever receives your message, it's as if they're receiving Jesus' message. The Bible said in 2 Corinthians that we pray you in Christ's stead. So in the place of God, be ye reconciled to God. Be ye reconciled to God. Right before that it says, as though God did beseech you by us. So it's exactly the same when you go to someone's door and you knock on their door and you're giving them the gospel. It's just like God set up a system where he's saying there's no difference. And when you're giving them the gospel, and then when Jesus Christ, while he was on this earth, for example, when he was giving the gospel to the Samaritan woman, it's exactly the same. Look at Matthew chapter 10, verse 40. We'll read that again. Matthew chapter 10, verse 40. So it says, he that receiveth you, receiveth me, and he that receiveth me, receiveth him that sent me. He that receiveth a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward. And he that receiveth a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward. And whosoever shall give to drink unto one of these little ones a cup of cold water only in the name of a disciple, verily, verily I say unto you, he shall in no wise lose his reward. Now, a representative or an ambassador is only as great as the person that's sending them. If you were to go around and you were able to speak to the European Union and the United Nations and ask questions to these people like, hey, how do you view the ambassador of this country? A really small country. Okay, how do you view the ambassador of Russia? Or how do you feel when you meet the ambassador of China? Or how do you feel when you meet the ambassador of the United States, larger countries? I would guarantee that they look up to the ambassador of a larger country, of a country with more power, with more money, things like that, much more than they would if they met, you know, someone from a very small, tiny country. An ambassador is only as great as the person that has sent him. Like it says in, look at verse 41, he that receiveth a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward. And then he says, and he that receiveth a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward. The reason why I read these verses, excuse me, is because people need to understand when they, as being an ambassador, whether you're going soul winning or whether you're not. Number one, if you're not going soul winning and you're not knocking on doors, you're not giving the gospel to people, then you need to understand what type of job was given to you for you to be doing. Now, whether you're doing that or not, that means nothing. But you need to understand how important of a job that it is. And also the same to those that are going out and those that are knocking on doors. You can just fall into a routine where you're just going through the motions and it doesn't seem that important to you anymore. You don't understand that, like, hey, when I knock on this door, I'm representing the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm representing the guy that said, hey, I'm the beginning and the ending, the first and the last. You know, there's obviously the creator of the ends of the earth. When you go knock on a door, you are literally representing You have the most important job that any ambassador has ever had, that has ever walked upon this planet. And people need to understand that when they go to the doors, because you know what they'll do? They'll start taking their job a lot more serious. I guarantee if you were to take one of these ambassadors that works for one of these smaller countries, and they worked there for 20, 30 years, and you were like, hey, you got a job change. Obviously, this has never happened. And you were to transfer him to like one of these larger countries, one of these countries with much more power, they'd be a little bit more nervous on the first day of the job, I guarantee it. So that shows that we need to understand, hey, we don't just have this small job of just, it's not very important. We are representing and we are ambassadors for the most important job of anyone that has ever walked upon this planet, of all the nations that have thrived and all the kingdoms, you know, that have had power. We have the most important job of any ambassador that has ever walked upon this planet. And you'll take your job more serious when you understand that. So turn to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. So obviously the first thing that an ambassador or a messenger, like the Bible used synonymous, the first thing that they need is they need a message. So look at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. The Bible tells us what our message is as ambassadors. So again, this is Paul speaking. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. The Bible says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And then he says this, and for me, that utterance may be given me, that I may open my mouth boldly, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. So notice what he says in verse 20. He says, for which. So what is he referring to? Look at the end of verse 19. To make known the mystery of the gospel, for which, referring to the gospel, I am an ambassador in bonds. So Paul says that what he's an ambassador for, that what the message that he's bringing is the gospel. And what is the gospel? It's the good news. That's what the gospel is. Turn to Isaiah chapter 33, verse 7. It's a message of peace. And all throughout the Bible, when you look at the different kings that are bringing, you know, or the different ambassadors that are bringing messages from kings, and you look at all the different ambassadors that are coming unto nations, they all show up with a message of peace. That's the reason why they're there. They're trying to, they're in the attempt to avoid a war. They're coming. Here's the thing. If they wanted to just come and just destroy the city, the worst thing you could do is come and tell them, hey, we're coming to destroy the city. They would rather the people just not be aware. But the purpose that you send an ambassador is because you desire conditions of peace. You desire for there to be peace. And the same thing goes for us as an ambassador. When we go and we knock on someone's door and we're representing Christ, we're not just coming there just to bring bad news. We're coming there primarily for the major purpose of, hey, a message of peace for good news. Now look at Isaiah chapter 33. Isaiah chapter number 33, and we'll look at verse number 7. Isaiah chapter number 33, verse number 7 says, behold, their valiant ones shall cry without. Now watch what he says. The ambassadors of peace shall weep. Shall weep bitterly. So he says, the ambassadors of peace shall weep bitterly. So he actually refers to them just in general, the ambassadors of peace, because that's the job of what an ambassador is given. He's given a job. Hey, I want you to go and I want you to try to negotiate. I want you to try to persuade this person to accept this, you know, consolation of peace, to try to reconcile this situation. And that's what the gospel is. The gospel is a message of peace. Romans chapter 10, verse 14 says, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? And then he says, as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace. So he calls it the gospel of peace. And bring glad tidings of good things. So we're there bringing glad tidings. We're there preaching the gospel of peace is another name for the gospel. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 15 it says, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Our job when we go to the door is to try to reconcile the relationship with the person that you're speaking to back to God. Your job, the ministry of reconciliation, is to bring back the relationship between that person. Just in general, our job is to reconcile all of mankind. That would be obviously our goal. It's never going to happen. You know, the Bible says that the majority of people are going to go to hell. But in general, our job is just to go out and preach the gospel like Jesus said to every creature and to preach a message of peace. Now, you turn to Deuteronomy chapter 20, verse 9. Luke 14:32 actually says this. Jesus, when he's speaking a parable, says, or else while the other is yet a great way off, talking about two kingdoms and one man is coming to the other kingdom, or one king, it says, he sendeth, so the king sends an ambassage and desireth conditions of peace. So notice, an ambassage is just another, it's just another form of the word of an ambassador. It's just another form of that same word, and he's sent there to desire conditions of peace. The Bible says that they are the ambassadors of peace. Us as ambassadors for Christ are sent forth, and our job is to preach a message of peace. Now look at Deuteronomy. That's our primary job. Deuteronomy chapter 20, verse number 9. Deuteronomy chapter 20, verse number 9. The Bible says, "And it shall be when the officers have made an end of speaking unto the people, that they shall make captains of the armies to lead the people. When thou comest nigh unto a city to fight against it, then proclaim peace unto it." Another word for proclaim is preach. And this is speaking about, you know, the Israelites being sent forth in different kingdoms and nations that they encounter. So here's another incident, not only when God sends us forth as ambassadors for Christ in the New Testament, even in the Old Testament he says it. Now look at verse 10 there again at the end. It says, "Then proclaim peace unto it." Verse 11, "And it shall be if it make thee answer of peace and open unto thee, then it shall be that all the people that is found therein shall be tributaries unto thee, and they shall serve thee." And then it says in verse 12, "And if it will make no peace with thee, but will make war against thee, then thou shalt besiege it. And when the Lord thy God hath delivered it into thy hands, thou shalt smite every male thereof with the edge of the sword." Our message is not only a message of peace, though. That's the primary purpose that we come and we knock on the door, but we have a two-part message. And they can't receive the good news without first at least acknowledging the bad news. Right. It's not just positive. Right when I show up to their door, 99% of people are going to hell, and I'm going to tell them that so that they can know how to get to heaven. Yeah, I'm there to tell people, hey, you can go to heaven. But I'm also there to warn people. And that's what an ambassador does. You can look at all kinds of different examples in the Bible of ambassadors being sent. You know, you can look at the example of when Rabshakeh was sent from Syria. And he goes there with a message. He at least attempts in the beginning to give a message of peace. And then the Israelites were hardened to it. And he ended up strongly rebuking them and telling them and giving them a warning. And when we knock on somebody's door, you know, I'm there to give them the gospel. I'm there to be friendly. I'm there to be kind. But if they end up rejecting and denying the gospel, I will make sure that I leave them with a very strong warning. When I leave, if a person has no interest in God, they have no interest in Jesus, they've listened to the entire gospel in a very friendly way, in a very nice way, I will make sure that they know that they are headed to hell. Our job is to bring a message of peace. That's primarily our job. But you better make sure that you don't fall too far on each side where you show up and you're just only preaching the positive, where you don't tell anybody that they're a sinner, where you don't tell people, hey, you're going to hell. One of the things specifically that I do in my soul winning, before I pray with a person, I make sure that I ask that person, it's in the same line of questions, hey, do you believe that Jesus is God? I ask that person, and I won't pray with that person unless they admit it. I say, do you believe that if you died right now, that you would go to hell? If you died right now, that you would go to hell? And if they say no, well, then I can't pray with that person. Then I just give them, you know, I'll show them more scriptures. You know, why? Because that's what the Bible teaches. But if they just keep rejecting what I show them, I am there also to give them a warning. We're sent forth, yeah. You know, we don't want to have the blood left on our hands at the end of the day. Obviously, we want to make sure that we knock on every single door and that we're there, like I said, to bring the message of peace. But you better make sure that you also have that balance, that you can only present the message of peace without presenting the negative side. So you have to make sure you're not only out there just, you know, preaching the positive side, but that you're also there to warn them. Just like, because our job as ambassadors has a two-part job. Just like those of the Old Testament, we can look at examples of different ambassadors of kingdoms and nations throughout history. Turn to Colossians chapter 4, verse 9. Colossians chapter 4, verse 9. Colossians chapter 4, verse 9. So number one, we need to bring a message of peace, but we also need to bring a message of a warning, a message of positive and also a message of negative. That's one of the jobs, that's one of the parts of, you know, being an ambassador. That's one of the needs. You have to have a message, and specifically our message is, you know, peace, but it's also a warning. Number two is that we, you know, an ambassador has to have communication skills. If we had an ambassador to the United States and we were sending that guy over to, you know, some other country, you know, wherever, you know, Botswana or something like that where Garrett's going, you know, he better know how to speak Setswana. He better know how to speak whatever language that it is, or he's going to be a useless ambassador. He needs to be able to communicate. But not only does he need to be able to speak the same language as them, he needs to be able to speak clearly. He may grow up with his mother tongue as English, and we might be sending this guy to as an ambassador to represent the United States or wherever, to another country that speaks English. But if he has poor communication skills and he's not able to speak plainly and to be understood, then he fails at his job. The number one part of being an ambassador is to communicate. The whole reason why you're sent forth as an ambassador is to be a messenger. You have a message. If you can't convey or communicate that message effectively, then you're failing as an ambassador. So we have to make sure that we can convey and we can present the message in an understandable manner. I'll read you from 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 7. It says this, "And even things without life-giving sound, whether pipe or harp, except they give a distinction in the sounds, how shall it be known what is piped or harped? For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to battle?" And that's kind of the same thing too, because like the watchman that's got the trumpet, he's blowing the trumpet for the purpose of warning people. And if people can't even understand you while you're out there trying to explain to them the gospel and you're trying to explain to them, that they're headed to hell, if they can't even understand you, then that falls back upon you. You're there for the purpose of trying to give them the gospel. And if you're fumbling around, you haven't done the studying, or you're not apt to it yet, you just need more practice, well, then that falls back on you. That's your fault. It says right after that, "So likewise, ye," so in the same way, "except ye utter by the tongue words easy to be understood, how shall it be known what is spoken? For ye shall speak into the air." He's talking about the importance of making sure that you're understood. When you speak to somebody, if you're not understood, you just wasted your breath. It was literally just like you were just speaking into the air. It was just a waste of breath. Look at Colossians chapter 4, verse 3. So it says, "With all praying also for us, that God would open unto us a door of utterance." And this verse right here is very similar to what we read in Ephesians 6 a moment ago. A door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds. So notice, to open unto us a door of utterance. Again, look at verse 4. It says, "That I may make it manifest as I ought to speak." So Paul says, when he writes the book of Colossians, Paul says that the way that he ought to speak, what he means by that is that's the way that he should speak. The way that we should speak, the way that we ought to speak, is to be made manifest. It's to be understood. The whole reason that an ambassador, is sent forth is, like I said, to bring a message. So the number one thing you better make sure at the door is, number one, you're bringing the right message. You're bringing not only just positive, but you're also giving the warning. You're giving the warning, obviously, with grace and meekness. You're giving the warning of, hey, the Bible teaches that we're all sinners. The Bible teaches that because of that, we deserve a punishment and we're going to hell. At the end, make sure you confirm with the person that you're speaking to. Hey, do you believe that you deserve to go to hell today? Well, actually, that's good news that I'm here because I can, I can say this prayer with you. At the very end, you can explain, finish up explaining everything, asking all the other questions. But make sure that you're not only preaching the positive, make sure you're giving the negative aspect of the message. And then number two, we need to make sure that when we speak, we are understood. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 12 says, "Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech." If a person wanted to brag about something about their gospel, if they wanted to boast about something about their gospel, it shouldn't be like, hey, I use all these other verses that nobody else uses. That's not good. If a person's going to brag about something about their gospel, they should be saying, hey, my gospel is so easy that literally a child at its lowest mental capacity of when they're able to understand the gospel, I can preach them the gospel and they can understand it. If something's special about your gospel, it's going to be special because it's simple to understand, because it's thorough, because it's very easy to understand. A special gospel or a fancy gospel with all the bells and all the whistles is not a good gospel. That means it's complicated. Like he says right here, it says we use great plainness of speech. What does something mean when it's plain? It means it's not complicated. It doesn't have a lot of special things added to it if something's really plain. It's just bare. You know, my gospel is a very simple, easy gospel. And I preach the exact same gospel that I preach to a 5-year-old, 6-year-old child, that they're able to understand it, that I preach to an adult. It's because my job is, when I go to their door, I'm not trying to impress them with all my Bible knowledge, and I'm not trying to impress my partner with how cool my gospel and how my gospel is better than his gospel. My job when I go to the door is to make sure that the person understands you're headed to hell, and hey, you know, I can show you how to get there. This is what the Bible teaches. There's only one thing that we have to do to get to heaven, and then show them Acts chapter 16, verse 31. Just show them how easy it is to go to heaven. Why would you show them how easy it is to go to heaven in a hard way? Makes no sense at all. When you go to their door, make sure that you're presenting the gospel, the free gift, in a very easy way. How sad would it be to waste the first 2 years, first 3 years of your soul winning time, and then find out once you get to heaven, or find out later on, like, hey, there was 20 to 25 people, 50 people, that when I was out giving my gospel those first years, that I was just giving it too complicated, I was trying to make it fancy, and literally 50 people went to hell because your gospel was too complicated. I mean, that's serious. Sometimes, you know, sometimes we can, because we do so much soul winning, we can become numb to how many people are getting saved and just kind of not look at, you know, the person that we're giving the gospel to and not care as much. You know, we need to make sure that we're using great plainness of speech. We need to make sure that we're being very clear. Turn back to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm going to point out another thing. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We need to make sure that our message is not only positive, we need to make sure that we're also presenting the negative. We need to have that perfect balance. It's primarily a positive message. But there is also a warning there, just like an ambassador of the Old Testament, just like an ambassador throughout any time. The whole purpose is, hey, I'm showing up, I desire conditions of peace. That's why I'm here. I want to show you how you can be reconciled to God, how you can know for sure you're going to heaven. That's the reason why I showed up to your door. But there's also the warning. They have to acknowledge the warning first. They have to acknowledge, hey, I'm going to hell, before they can even accept, you know, the free gift of eternal life, before they can even believe on Christ. Number two, we need to make sure that we're using great plainness of speech. And then number three is, look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Look at verse number 18 first, where the Bible says, "And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation." Now watch this, and now read verse 19. But notice the ministry of reconciliation. Verse 19, it says, "To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them." Now watch this. "And hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation." So the first time he says that, he gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Then he uses synonymously, just in the very next breath, he says that he committed unto us the word of reconciliation. When we go forth, an ambassador does not decide what message they're bringing. And they don't, you know, tailor or customize their message. Well, I didn't really like that part that the king told me to say, so I'm going to say this. They bring the message that the king dictates. Then Jesus Christ, the Bible, has dictated what message you're supposed to bring. And it's not the testimony of reconciliation. It's not you just go around in your own words and tell people how you think people are going to get to heaven and how you believe that people are going to get to heaven. The Bible says that the message as an ambassador that you are supposed to bring is the word of reconciliation. Amen. If you go to somebody's door and you try to preach that person the gospel without using a stitch of scripture, without quoting a single Bible verse, that person was just as much going to hell when you left as they were before you got there.
Right. Yep.
A person cannot be saved without the word of God, without a doubt. There is no question about that, and the Bible is very clear about that. You know, the Bible says that I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. Now turn to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. We'll see what it is about the gospel that we have to preach. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. Because that's what a person would say. You quote a verse like that to somebody, you know, a person will say, yeah, you just need to give them the gospel in your own words. Well, look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. The Bible says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Not by your testimony, not by your words. The Bible says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. When God, you know, assigned you the job as an ambassador, he tells you what message you are to preach. And he said it's the word of reconciliation. It's the word of reconciliation. The Bible also says that he begat us with the word of truth.
Right.
We're saved by the the Word of God. And a person has to have the Word of God. And when I say the Word of God, I don't just mean any version. I mean, you better have the King James Bible in your hand when you're knocking on that person's door. Or it doesn't matter, you might as well just give them your own testimony. That's how much junk, you know, that's in all these other Bible versions. You know, there's not enough in all the modern Bible versions that are coming out nowadays. It, you know, occasionally in the New King James you can find some verses, but all the other ones, they are so far off from being the Word of God, and they are so far off from aligning with the King James Bible, that you probably couldn't find enough of the gospel message in an NIV or any of the other versions to get a single person on this planet saved. Amen. So when you go to somebody's door, make sure you have a King James Bible. Make sure you have, you know, God's true Word. Look at verse number 23, 1 Peter chapter 1. It says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible. And so when he says being born again, he's saying, you know, we had a first birth, which was of corruptible seed. It was of corruption. Our second birth, we're not born of incorruptible, we're not born of corruption. It says, but of incorruptible seed. And then he tells you what that incorruptible seed is. By the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. The Bible says that when you're born again, if you're born again, you are born again by the Word of God. You are born again by the Bible, by God's Word. And here's the thing, these versions are not the same. I don't care who you are. The only way that you can sell one of these versions and to get a copyright is if it's a certain percentage different.
Right.
4%, is that what it is? I think it changes, doesn't it?
It's
is it 4%? Is it? Yeah. Well, either way, they have to be different. That's the point. You know, the versions have to be different from one another. So, you know, you can't say, well, they're all just the same. They're all the Word of God. They're not the same. They can't have the copyright if they're not the same. And the reason why all the Bible versions come out is obviously for money.
Right.
You know, so they keep coming out with all these different Bible versions throughout, you know, all the years. But we need to stay with the tried and the true. But look what it says. By the Word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away, but the word of the Lord endureth forever. So he's comparing right now the Word of God, the Spirit of God, with flesh. And he says, the flesh is corruptible, the Spirit of God, the Word of God is incorruptible. Watch what he says at the end here in verse 25. But the word of the Lord endureth forever, and this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. I've had people say to me before, hey, you can. It's just the gospel that saves. Just tell them the gospel in your own words. But look at the very end of verse number 25. He says, and this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. We're there bringing the gospel. You're 100% accurate. But you better make sure that you're using the Bible, you're using Bible verses when you're presenting the gospel. When you tell somebody, hey, Jesus Christ died on the cross, use a Bible verse to tell them that. When you tell somebody, hey, the way you get to heaven is you must believe on Jesus Christ, you better go to like Acts chapter 16, verse 31, pick your own verse. But you better be using the Bible. You can't just tell them the gospel in your own words. That person has to have God's Word, the power of God's Word, in order to get them saved.
Amen.
Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1. So number one, again, we have to proclaim and preach peace like it said as ambassadors do, but we also have to make sure that we're warning people. Primarily, we're there with a message of peace, but we also have to make sure that we're giving the warning as well. Number two, we need to speak plainly. We need to speak clearly to make sure that we're understood. And then number three, we need to use God's word as ambassadors. God decides, God dictates the message, just like any king dictates a message. So you, as an ambassador for Christ, you know, you were committed the ministry of reconciliation. You were also committed the word of reconciliation. Your job and ministry is work to do. Your job is to go out and to preach the gospel and to represent Christ and to give the gospel. But you need to make sure that you're using the word, that you're doing it right. You're doing it by the way that the King sent you. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 19. I read this earlier, but I'm going to read it again. This is my last point, is when we preach, we need to preach boldly. We need to preach boldly. I'm just going to just read this one verse for you for this point. It says, and for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. I compared that other verse that we used earlier to this because they're so similar in Colossians. The other one said that I may make it manifest, or that I may speak, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. So he said the way that you should speak is to speak clearly to make it manifest. Here he says that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. So yeah, you need to speak clearly. You ought to speak clearly when you go to the door. The way you should be giving the gospel is in a clear, you know, with great plainness of speech, like the Bible said. But right here, two times, there is the admonition to make sure that you're preaching the gospel at the door boldly. When a vacuum salesman comes to your door, just as an example, you can tell whether he believes in the product that he's trying to send, that he's trying to sell to you. He's either a good liar or he believes the product. A lot of vacuum sales are probably good liars, I assume. But you can tell whether a person is convinced or persuaded themselves about what they believe. And if you knock on somebody's door and you're not really sure about what you're saying, they're not going to be as interested in the Bible. They're not going to be as interested in Jesus, and they're not going to be as interested in the gospel. I would be much more interested in somebody that's like, hey, I know 100% sure I'm going to heaven and I can show you how. I'm not going to be interested in a person that's like, I think I'm going to heaven. The Bible's pretty cool. Would you like me to show you? Obviously, they're not going to be interested in listening to you. They want someone, you know, they need someone to come to their door. The way we ought to speak is we need to speak boldly. You know, we have the gospel there. You know, we're ambassador. You need to look at who you're an ambassador for. And even more so than of any nation, of any ambassador that's ever lived upon this earth, including ourselves, who should be bold? Us. You know, obviously we're representing the King of Kings, like I said before. We're representing, you know, the creator of all the earth. If anyone of any ambassadors should be bold, then we should be. We need to understand that what we have in our hands and the power that we have in our hands and who we're representing and who we're standing in the stead of. And understand how important the job is. He said, we pray you in Christ's stead. Like we're standing in the place of Christ, literally. He said, he that receiveth you, receive as me. So we need to understand the importance of that. We'll end right here in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse number 1. So this is, you know, this is the chapter, you know, immediately preceding where we started. You know, chapter 5 at the very end there is where it talks about being ambassadors for Christ. But chapter 3, 4, and 5. Chapter 3 is really the introduction about the ministry that we're given. Chapter 4, he starts discussing more about that ministry and about preaching the gospel. You know, we have the famous verse in verse 3, but it says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. You know, that famous passage there. So the discussion is the ministry that's given unto us and going out and soul winning. Notice what he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1. We're going to end on this verse. It says, therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not. And what does it mean to faint not? It means not to get tired, not to give up. When you realize, like, hey, you know, I'm an ambassador for the creator of the earth. I'm an ambassador for the Lord of Lords, for the King of Kings, the greatest person that could have sent me. I'm representing literally the greatest person that, you know, that has existed and will ever exist, you know, the beginning and the ending. And when you go to somebody's door, if you keep that in mind, like, hey, this is the reason I'm there, it's probably going to change the way that certain people dress when they go out soul winning. It's probably going to change the way that certain people act, the way that they talk to people. Maybe they wouldn't say something that they thought about saying, you know, that maybe disgraced Christ or something like that. When you understand the importance of who you're representing and being an ambassador. So different things, just as a quick recap or review, different things that we need in order to be a good ambassador. In order to be a good soul winner is, number one, we need to bring a message. And the message is not only a message of peace. It's primarily a message of peace. And that's the reason why you're coming to the door, is to preach the gospel, a message of peace. But it's also the warning. Make sure that you warn people if they reject the gospel. Make sure that you're giving the warning anyways. But make sure you're giving a firm warning if they end up rejecting or just denying Christ. You know, number two is we need to use great plainness of speech. Seeing that we have this hope, we need to use great plainness of speech. Make sure that we're clear, that we communicate well, and that we're understood well. And then number three, the last point was that we needed to preach boldly. And then number three was that we needed to use the Word of God when we're out. We need to use the message that was given unto us. God gave us a message, and it's the Bible. And that's what, when we go to somebody's door, not just there bringing our own message, we're not just there, you know, paraphrasing the Bible. We're there, we need to be quoting Scripture, because that's where the power of God lies. And we need to make sure that we follow these steps as an ambassador in order to be an effective ambassador for Christ. In order to fulfill our duty or our job. Because it's a job. People get paid to be ambassadors today. You know, this is a job and responsibility that we have. Number one, to go out and go soul winning. And then number two, to follow the course and follow, you know, the different responsibilities that we have as ambassadors for Christ. Let's bow and have a quick word of prayer. Heavenly Father God, we thank you for the privilege and the opportunity, you know, to be ambassadors for you, dear Lord. We thank you, dear Lord God, for your word and all the power that's in it, dear Lord, and that we can go to the door and just so easily and so simple we can give the gospel to people and have them, you know, believe on Christ and trust Christ. We thank you just for your the whole word, dear Lord, all the things that are unto our edification and that we can learn from. We love you. Just please be with us today and help us to have a great day and bless us this the rest of this service and also the services that are to come today. And in Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen.